Let's talk about your recent post here of last month, The Unsustainable Reality Revisions and the Order Out of Chaos Birth.
Okay, before we do that, I know that both of us probably have some new listeners, so I want to back up just a little bit. I'm a pattern person. Patterns are really, really important, and I want to talk about those in just a moment. But what I did years ago, I refer to it as the 30,000 foot view, although it's kind of more than that. So I came to the realization that there are very specific patterns that lead to the demise of an entire civilization. It's happened before. We're doing it again. We've been here. We've done this before. We're on the spin cycle. So from that perspective, if you can imagine, you know, you're standing in your front yard and you see all of the little dramas playing out around you. But if you can zoom out, and pretty soon you see these dramas are playing out everywhere in different cities, and then you zoom out again, and then it's different countries, and pretty soon you're kind of out in space looking at the Earth, and you look to your left and you see the patterns of the past. You look straight ahead and you see the patterns of the now. And with what's happened in the past and the current patterns, you can see the future by making projections as to what will happen if they continue. So this is basically what my work is centered on doing, helping people to see that this has happened before and how it's happened. And once you have that overview, then you have to begin to zoom back in and drill down into how is it happening, why is it happening, and who's behind it, and so forth, and all of those kinds of things. What's the manner in which it's happening? And I think more importantly, why don't people know? How is that being kept from them? Why is it being allowed to continue without resistance? So that's the bulk of what I do, and I do it as many different ways as I can find, because people think differently. Everybody thinks very, very differently. So, you know, looking at it through this perspective is only going to reach people who can view it through that perspective. So I'm constantly looking for new ways to help people understand what's happening. One of the major points that I began talking about from the beginning in the early days, I started doing this in 2009, is intelligent design and why that is so important to understand. And this is the patterns, okay? And we are not being taught design because of what's being done to it by those who understand it. And this is the dumbing down process. When I say patterns, this is how we know that there is a design. We can see the repetition of the patterns. We can see what they do. Patterns are how we've learned everything we know. What numbers? It's pattern recognition. Is that a number three? Does it look like a number three? It's got the pattern of a number three. Numbers, letters, words, sentences, paragraphs, birds, plants, animals, it's all pattern recognition. And it's very, very important that people return to this understanding. This is how we learn the distinctions between different species and genus types, chemistry, biology, geology, metallurgy, meteorology, astronomy, all of it is the design. And when people know the design, when they have this knowledge, and I'm not talking about a religious perspective, I'm not talking about that. I think religion has been a massive failure in the sense that it encourages elitism amongst different sects of people. And in that place, in that mind space of, I'm, you know, my God's better than your God, I've got the right name, and I'm descendant of the real God and you aren't. If there's a design, there's a designer. I don't care what people want to call the designer. You can call it Steve, you can call it Jenny, you can call it Allah. I don't really care. People have a right to refer to whatever they want to, but they don't have a right to kill other people who disagree with what they've decided to call it. And in the middle of all this fighting and arguing, and these are the little dramas, you know, if we pan the camera all the way in, people are squabbling over things that don't matter. They are all in agreement that there is a creator, and yet, while they're squabbling over who and what it is and looks like and what it's called, what that creator is has created, which we must have to survive, is being systematically destroyed in the background, and they're not paying any attention. That's a huge, huge problem. So design is so very, very important. And this, again, is the dumbing down process. And many times I like to explain, I refer to intelligent design as the sacred science. I know there's another group using that term. I don't know them. I don't know what they mean by that. But what I mean by it is intelligent design is what gives every living thing on this planet life. And if that is not sacred, then nothing is. So I think we should view it as sacred. And I'm not talking about Gaia worship. We'll get to that. I'm talking about science, factual science. When we understand how things work, we can't be snowed. I often refer to it as a type of virtual reality program, and I never mean that in the sense that it isn't real, because suffering and starving and dying children with their limbs blown off, it's real. It's very real. I just mean it in the sense that creational design is very much like a computer program, in that everything is coded, we could say, as an analogy, to interact with and function with all of these other codes. So the smaller things are building on the larger things. They're creating it. So for example, you've got letters. It's fractal too. So if we use writing in the alphabet as an example, you've got the alphabet. That's the tiny scale. When you string these letters together in certain combinations, you create a word. Now you've moved up the scale. When you put words together in a certain order, you get a sentence. You've moved up the scale. When you put sentences together, you get a paragraph, and then you get books and you get libraries. This is the way it's designed. This is how it works. When you change something, you've automatically changed the others. If you change one thing, you change the others. The reason we are not being taught any of this, it has nothing to do with religion, although that's the reason that they give of why they cannot teach design in school. Because obviously if there's a design, there's a designer, and then the whole religious separation of church and state and all that nonsense comes into the equation. But that's not really what's going on here. The same way people can create a virus, if they know the source code of a program, they can create a virus that can go in and reprogram the code, and then it doesn't function anymore. The same thing happens with vaccines, okay? And they know the design of the body enough that they can inject people with vaccines that will rewrite their biology and change the way their body functions. This is how women, I think it started in the Philippines, were given vaccines with a specific ingredient that made them sterile. They now have antibodies to pregnancy. That was done by people who understand the biological design of the body enough to hack it and alter it. That's what they've done. They have done this with food. This is genetically modified food. They've done it with fluoride. They know what fluoride does. They've done it with weather. This is weather modification. And this is the problem, and this is why civilizations who weaponize their technology cannot survive it, because the design is the technology. That is where every advanced technology we have is based on design. That's where it comes from. It doesn't matter what it is, it's based on the design. So if we understood that, and if we understood the design and were properly taught the design, they could not get away with what they're doing, because we would know where it goes. And what they are doing is weaponizing intelligent design and turning it in on itself. Here on this planet, we refer to intelligent design as nature, but we don't refer to nature on the large scale, do we? We don't look at the sun and call it nature. It's design is what it is. But if we are just going to refer to it here on a small scale and call it nature, they are killing nature to kill us. And this has consequences. It's not survivable long term. Now there's a pattern behind this. Why does it become weaponized? How does that begin? And this that I'm going to share with you now is actually on my blog, which is, I've changed it. It's drowninginabsurdity.org. But if you use the WordPress address, you'll still get there, so that doesn't really matter. But there's a formula. There are phases to this. The first phase, this is one of the worst things. This is where it begins, and it doesn't matter how far back you go. If you want to go back, 2, 3, 4, 5,000 years, this is the beginning of the phase of self-destruction, the demise of entire civilization. And it's immoral, and it's inequitable, but it's survivable as a whole. And by a whole, I'm talking about the entire planet, the entire civilization of Earth can survive this when it begins. And this is elitism, both narcissistic and psychopathic forms, because this begins the first division or compartmentalization and disconnection of humanity into two main groups or subdivisions that are no longer working together towards the same evolutionary goals. So this marks even the beginning of what you now have people calling a breakaway civilization. This is where it begins. This mindset is bent on domination, you know, and that's the progression of elitism and its need to dominate and control other people. This begins the dichotomy expression through wealth, where you have knowledge versus privilege, poverty versus lack, ignorance versus knowledge, freedom versus slavery, the self-appointed divine right of kingship and monarchies versus serfdom, I'm sorry, free people, and you've got serfdom and a feudalism. You've got the corruption of justice, because now you've got justice versus what we are supposed to consider justice. And then from this point, as it progresses, you know, think back in the Dark Ages, okay? It starts a very long time ago. As it progresses, you see more regional wars, and you see alliances become more prominent to secure and consolidate more wealth, more resources, and more power for the continuance of this agenda, of this elitist agenda. That's the first phase. Phase two is not survivable long term. And this is when we get into advanced technology. This is when, the industrialized revolution and those kinds of things. We're working our way towards more and more advanced technology. And as the technology advances, more and more of the design becomes involved in the technology. So when you have the commingling, the commingling of elitism and advanced scientific knowledge, this accelerates planetary-wide destruction through the increased perpetuation of ignorance to stifle resistance, expansion of global wars for greater control over resources, and that's natural resources, technological resources, financial resources, in conjunction with accelerated alterations, violations, and weaponization of natural laws on a global scale. This manifests the beginning stages of global genocide by turning nature in on itself, restricting public access to advanced cures, medical technologies, and significant non-polluting energy-producing technologies. So any new advances that are made are reserved for the few. That's phase two. Phase three, which we are in now, and we are well within this phase, is not survivable short-term. Maybe 50 to 100 years, and I would say we've probably only got maybe a decade left, okay? And this is the manipulating of the global general population to participate in their own demise out of ignorance. Once a specific level of ignorance has been socially engineered into the public over several generations, in conjunction with the first two steps, which also include the suppression and sequestration of archaeological finds and ancient texts, strategically applied propaganda, perception management, and psychological techniques, or warfare, are used to manipulate the public into willfully and aggressively participating and therefore quickening their own demise. Ill health, poverty, slavery, all of those things, these people are actually participating in under the false pretense of saving themselves and their planet. So this is the con. This is the gigantic con. And of course, global warming is a perfect example of this. And this is where reality revision becomes so important to understand. When they began talking about greenhouse gases, I started writing my first book. I finished it in 2008. I released it in 2000, and as you said, I removed it from circulation a couple of years ago to revise it. But I started writing it, it took a few years to write, about around 2004. And at that time, if you did a search, an internet search, for the term greenhouse gases, you got page after page after page of companies selling carbon injection kits for greenhouses because it's plant food. When they began to revise reality to get more people to participate in their own demise out of ignorance, and because these people don't have knowledge of intelligent design, they don't resist. They listen to what the fellow on the television says. He's got a nice suit, and he speaks well, so he must know what he's talking about, right? As they begin to revise reality, and they trotted out Al Gore and his Inconvenient Truth, within 3 years, doing a search for greenhouse gases would pull up nothing but Al Gore and global warming. That's a digital reality revision, okay?
Oh, okay.
They caught. Okay. they caught on. People caught on to the greenhouse gas revision or narrative, which is a fiction, because people knew it's plant food. They were putting it in their greenhouses for a higher yield. It's absurd. So this is where rebranding also comes in. And rebranding is also a way of letting people know that a revision is either in process or coming based on the change in language. So they rebranded they rebranded it from greenhouse gases to global warming. Well, then we had ClimateGate. You remember that when all those emails were leaked and all of these scientists signed this petition saying they know that global warming is a lie, and then the emails from the IPCC scientists came out where they were talking about how they were falsifying the data for an agenda.
Oh yeah.
So then it was time to rebrand it again. They rebranded it as climate change. These are revisions. These are reality revisions. And this is the methodology that I'm trying to help people see, because while they may not have the knowledge of intelligent design they need to see through the lies or the revisions, if they at least know the methodology and how it's instituted, they can begin to work against it and think for themselves. So that's really important. So along those lines, I'm going to read the definition of a reality revision. This is in an essay on my website. This one is called, this is the first one. It's called The Roles of Perception Management and Social Engineering in Reality Revisionism. And this is the definition, which is in the essay. Reality revisions are agenda-driven and thereby fictitious narratives carefully scripted to revise an entire global reality in order to meet or fulfill that agenda. These are major, major paradigm shifts of generational proportions that summarily pre- and redefine the future victor and victimhood status of billions. These shifts aren't meant to change the perception and therefore direction of reality for a day, week, or months, but permanently. These revisions are as horrendous as they are gargantuan in sheer size and scope. Their purpose is to forever alter the organic course of the human race in the writer's favors, and with a body count already in the multi-millions, will stop at nothing to achieve it. So that is what it is. But this is why it's done. These revisions are not only the cause of every major war this planet has ever seen, including class and weather warfare, but have also repeatedly ensured the wrong people were targeted in nearly every case. That would be the competition or competing reality, up to and including actions that support it and those who know what it is. So then we get into, well, what is the competing reality? What are they? And this is the crux of the matter. This is the entire, this is the problem the entire human race is struggling with right now, and they don't even realize they're struggling with it. And this goes back to what we talked about in the beginning, where the split happens, and you have these people, these people that suffer from a form of self-deluded gross pomp and believe that they're their own species of humans and that they're smarter, their bloodlines are better, and the rest of us are these lesser races of Lilliputians that, because they're so much more intelligent than us, it's their right, and in fact they're burdened to have to manage the rest of us. Okay, this is where all of this starts, and we are seeing the fruition of it now. So there are warring realities, and this is very, very important to communicate, because as long as these two realities are struggling, the other one can never fully exist. Okay? So this also comes from the essay. Still largely unbeknownst to most, we live in a world in which two competing realities are constantly struggling for full manifestation. As one of them seeks to wholly dominate and fully replace the other through various methods of suppression and eradication, while the other entirely rejects such notions to the degree of criminal prosecution, they cannot peacefully coexist ever. As long as this struggle continues, so too will global war, famine, corruption, injustice, and strife, and ultimately the continued demise of our entire planetary civilization via the purposeful destruction of its life support systems. Mankind can no longer continue to participate in their own demise out of ignorance of this war and escape that demise at the same time. The struggle is between the sovereign state, country, or individual owning their own thought, action, and right to self-determination, and a private group of aspiring Caesars in the global governance regime they intend to replace the other reality with. This ultimate global reality revision cannot fully manifest without transferring to itself all of the sovereign power and freedoms of the other. So what do I mean by that? Why can't they fully exist? Because in order for this new reality that's trying to manifest itself fully, which is responsible for all of these reality revisions, it must fully consume every individual freedom we have, because it's like a dial. The more freedom we have, the less power they have. The more power they have, the less freedom we have. You turn one side up, the other goes down. They are ultimately hoping to turn the dial all the way off for us. That's very, very important to communicate. So from here, we have to begin to ask ourselves, well, who are these people? You know, what's going on? Well, that's the goal. That's what's happening. This is exactly what's happening, and this is why we have to do something about it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there are patterns to this, too, okay? It's so much like a script, so I'm going to go through some of the steps that they use, okay?
Probably even recognize a few of these, but go on.
Okay. So, reality revisions are handled and treated in much the same manner as a literal script. There's a story, there's a plot, there's characters, they have to be carefully developed over time. And it has to be done properly because, you know, that's the difference between a huge blockbuster and a B-rated movie. But in this case, we're talking about reality, an entire global reality, okay? So setting everything up carefully is very important to selling this. So with this in mind, we can look at changes in the narrative, which Orwell talked about, very, very important. We talked about that a little bit. Okay, because these changes in language are slowly building and creating a new reality revision, and these are the steps, okay? This is what it requires. First and foremost, you have to have the originators, the imaginers, and benefactors of the new reality, or the story, the script. So the second thing you have to have is the funding and the wealth transfers, because productions are expensive, and the size of the production is equal to the size of the funding or transfer. So when you start to see massive transfers of wealth, what you're seeing are the expense costs of continuing the next phase of the production. Do you follow me?
Yes, I do.
Okay.
Yes, I do.
So before 9/11, $3 trillion disappeared. Okay.
Before, wasn't it?
That's right. So here's the thing. This is what I'm saying. These people are not going to use their own money to fund this global reality revisionist production. They aren't going to do it. They're using our money, and that's what the transfers of wealth are for, and war is also a transfer of wealth. Then you have script writers, you have managing agents, you have props and sets, you have lead actors and actresses, you have supporting actors and actresses, and you have to have opposing ideologies. You have to have heroes and villains, you have to have victims and victors. There has to be a theater of some sort, some type of a venue or showcase. There's a sales force for marketing and repetitive reference. And then you also have something I refer to as lateral narrative binders.
So, God, it sounds like the script of a movie.
Yeah.
Oh?
Yeah, and this particular essay actually goes through 9/11 and shows people exactly how the script was applied in that order to 9/11. And so it's really important that we begin to understand their methodology. Now, revising an entire global reality, whenever there's a reality revision, there are inconsistencies in the storyline. Okay? Some people refer to these as anomaly, but there are gaps. There are, and this was very beautifully portrayed in the Matrix trilogy when Neo saw the cat walk by twice. He saw that same black cat, and they wanted to know, was it the same cat? And then they explained to him, when you see these glitches in the continuity, it means they've changed something. And this is exactly right. And this is why lateral narrative binders are so important, because they loop thought. They loop thought into this circular reference, and it creates a form of psyche, or what some people refer to as psychic block, that prevents them from seeing what Neo saw. Most people today, when a reality revision is taking place, don't see that. So in this sense, in the real world, We're talking about billions of people that you're having to snow, okay? And it's difficult. So there are always glitches. And that's what these narrative binders are for. Okay, so there, now this is beyond leader supporting actors, and these operate outside of normal marketing parameters. These
can
kinds
I
of
give,
things.
Can I interrupt here and give you a few of those clues that I have recognized just in mainstream media?
Sure.
Let's go back to September 11th, 2001. You remember the whole day they kept replaying the same clips, the videos, over and over and over and over and over again.
That's right.
That's the setting of the program.
That's right.
And if you ever notice, local news is even doing this now, and especially national news and cable channels.
That's right.
They always have this. As the shows are coming on, they always have these, a lot of flashes, a lot of busyness. They've got scrolls rolling at the bottom of the stock market. They've got these pop-ups. This is all design. I've noticed this.
It's theater.
It absolutely is theater.
All of it.
It's the mind control, the influencing of the mind using these flashes. They used to call it subliminal messages back in the 70s. I remember this. And they were caught doing it. Well, they're still doing it, not just using digital technology that mask it even more. But there are hidden messages. I've actually found a few of them on the internet of how they're doing it. And it's taking it down to the digital. It's taking it down to the digital code and how they're imprinting this into the videos, even if it's a live feed. It's not just on video anymore. So what is that saying? Well, they're only going to show you, and they want you to see things in repetition over and over again. But as the years progressed, we had Zeitgeist that came out and actually zoomed in on some of these photos they were showing and showing, hey, this is what they didn't show you. And remember the burst at every 13th floor, there was a burst of energy. And they were saying, well, those were windows that were blowing out and, you know, from the compression of the building falling. Uh-uh. You're not going to have it at every 13th floor. And what was blowing out should have been glass and paper. It was powder. It was explosive. It was the exhaust from an explosive blast. They've already proven that. And then that's just one aspect. So,
yeah, that's just one aspect. Well, yeah. There's more to that, and I'll get to that in just a moment. Okay, so lateral narrative binders are used to hide the cracks between the bricks in the story. It's used to hide the holes or the discontinuity, okay? So these are like glue and filler that are used to bind the narrative really tight together so that those other things, those anomalies, become imperceptible within the minds of the intended audience. And this is through constant redirection back to the narrative or revision. It's the mortar, the filling, hiding the spaces or discontinuity. In a real world scenario, lateral narrative binders are infiltrating our daily lives in the margins before the audience has shown up to watch the production and continue long after people have, quote, left the theater. So this is part of the pre-selling of an event that's going to come that the audience member, which is us, does not yet know is going to happen. So this pre-selling is, what do they call that? I'll give you an example of it. It's psychological. It's subliminal, but not in the sense of flashing messages. It's predictive in a sense. So, for example, the Boston Marathon bombing. Before that happened, a month or so before, Nike had this poster of a new shoe that it was marketing that was on the foot of a calf with the flesh blown off as though it had been in a bombing. Predictive programming, that's what I'm looking for. So we see this predictive programming. Of course, you've seen 9/11, you know, the cartoons. Okay, so you have this predictive programming. That's part of it, okay, but that's only part of it because all of these things, they're working in the periphery of your life. They don't have a major role, but they're beginning to alter thought patterns and move these thought patterns in the direction of the narrative that's beginning to change to set up the reality revision so that when it happens, people are already thinking in that direction and don't question it. You see what I'm saying?
Movie plots. No, okay.
Yeah, okay,
They did this in
exactly.
movies big time.
That's exactly right. Now, if we go back to that movie plot idea and we look at 9/11, remember you have to have opposing ideologies. On 9/11, what were the opposing ideologies? We had evil terrorist Muslim Arabs versus the good American Christian Anglo-Saxons, basically, right? Okay, those are the two, and then you have the villains and the victors and all of this. And so this is when the terrorist villain entered the story or narrative. And this was imperative that they do this because reality revisions build on each other. So they wanted to, the intention was always to begin to expand, wildly expand the definition of a terrorist. But in order to do that, you have to introduce the villain into the story first, don't you? So in the beginning, we were all told, oh, 9/11 was these Arabs that hate us for our freedom. And over again, they said that we were attacked by people that hate us for our freedom. I want you to think about that because in the beginning, what did I say those two competing realities are? Yes, we were attacked by people who hate our freedom because it limits their power, but it was not Arabs. That's not what happened. So now that the terrorist has been introduced into the narrative as the villain, it's being rebranded. And now we have what they refer to as homegrown terrorists, right? And then pretty soon Christians were on the terror list
Oh,
and
yeah.
returning veterans and now people that protest. And now they have also, and all of this is in this essay in great detail. They have also began to change the language again, and now they have something called the nonviolent extremist. And this is where the thought police come in. This is what they're for. People don't understand this. There's an article on my blog called Reality, and it talks about how the winners rewrite reality. And this is exactly what they're doing. And this leads to reality revisionism and is very similar. But if you go back and you look at a way of life, a form of top-down dominance over people's lives, and we look at the Inquisitions and the witch hunts, you were actually murdered if you did not behave the way they mandated you must behave as a human being. So your right to self-determination was taken from you and replaced with their version of reality so that you would, through force and fear, help them create it and sustain it and prop it up. But this is what happens when you use strong arm tactics like that, and people know that if they get caught thinking unsanctioned thoughts, that they can be, put to the test or the Iron Maiden and all these other torture techniques, they go underground because they know. So they hide their paraphernalia, they're harder to find. So when you get to the phase that we're in, you have to be creative, don't you? So you create social networks and you encourage everyone to share everything they do, everything they believe, and then we have the tracking. And this is what personal disposition matrices are, and this should raise an eyebrow for people because when Obama encountered resistance over his drone kill list, he rebranded it a disposition matrix. So they are building disposition matrix personality profiles on everyone on this planet, and that's what the surveillance is for. And they are looking for the heretics and dissenters from the official narrative of reality. They are not looking for terrorists, which is why they don't ever find any. Because now we've been encouraged to tell on ourselves, haven't we? We're not underground. We're saying, oh yes, I read these kinds of books. I watch these kind of movies. This is what I think about this. This is what I think about that. So that's really important. That's what all of the surveillance is for. They're going to weed us out at some point if we don't stop this, assuming we actually even get that far, given how badly they're destroying the environment at the moment. But I really want people to understand this. All of this tracking is not for your security and your protection. It's for their security and their protection because they're learning which ones of you really know what's going on and will not go along with their new reality. That's what they're looking for. Okay, so then we have the order out of chaos methodology. Oh, before I get to that, let's go back to 9/11. Are you familiar with Dmitry Kolesov?
Oh, the name does sound familiar, but I can't picture his face.
Okay. Remember when I was talking about earlier about how they are revising things on the internet so that you can no longer find references to the original reality, okay?
Right.
They're revising things. Okay, he worked, he was a Russian. You can find, people can find this on my blog as well. If they just type in 9/11, they'll find it. But he knew that they used mini nukes on 9/11. Not just mini nukes. They also used, like you said, they used explosives. There's evidence that there was thermite. But they also used mini nukes, and he became aware of it because of the non-proliferation treaty, in which we had to share with Russia any peaceful uses of nuclear bombs. And here's the interesting thing. There were two buildings built this way, the towers and the Sears Tower in Chicago, which Silverstein also tried to purchase.
Mm-hmm.
Because they had to prove that these buildings could be brought down on their own footprint, and using mini nukes was part of that design, which is how he knows. So there's a brilliant presentation. It's several hours long that he gave. It's on my website. But here's what's really interesting, okay? This is the reality revision that's happening to hide what he knows. What did they call what happened at 9/11? What did they call it? They called it Ground Zero. Ground Zero meant, at the time, in a dictionary, the space directly above or at a nuclear detonation. Dmitry went back through all of these dictionaries, and they have altered the definition of Ground Zero. They have even backdated these digital dictionaries and removed it. It doesn't have the original definition anymore, okay? This is reality revisionism.
Oh, wow.
Okay, so let's talk about a little bit about the other essay, and this is, let me see, what was this one called? These all go together. This one is called Unsustainable Reality Revisions and the Order Out of Chaos Birth. This is really, really important because this is something that people can't grasp. Although, again, this mentality has been seeded into the collective through the periphery, through movies and whatnot. When we see this satanic or demonic figure standing there triumphantly in front of a scorched earth in the background, and then we wonder at the logic, you know, what was the point of destroying something that you actually wanted to rule over a dead world, right? Why would you do that? This is what people don't understand. This is what Order Out of Chaos methodology is for, because it's based on the principle of building the new world on the ashes of the old one. So, and this is what I was talking about before from the other essay. We have two different realities competing for full manifestation, and they neither can fully manifest as long as the other exists.
Oh my God, the last Superman movie, Man of Steel. That was the entire plot. You just said it right there.
I didn't see it, so I don't know.
Oh, my God, when you see it, I mean, it's so blatantly out there.
Yes.
Right there in front of you, and if people can't understand that, we're in a lot of trouble. You know, humanity is in serious, serious problems right now. So, folks, I hope if you're listening to this, go back and listen to it again. There are times I need to watch things or listen to things two and three times. So continue, please.
Okay. So some of what I'm going to read now comes from this essay, and I'll try to paraphrase it, but it's important that people understand Order Out of Chaos methodology, because this is the way in which this is part of the reality revisionism methodology. And when you can identify these patterns, you can see them working everywhere, and then you know they're changing something, and you can go back and look for the factual reality behind it that they're trying to hide. That's really important. So part of the Order Out of Chaos methodology is not just building the ashes, the new world on the ashes of the old one, and having to completely blot out and consume one to manifest the other. But it has memes that go along with it that are almost in and of themselves a form of lateral narrative binder, and one of them is the incompetence meme, okay? So I'm going to read this brief paragraph to help summarize what I mean here. In the same way our ignorance is their strength and our individual freedoms inhibit their collective power, so too is our chaos their order. They cannot have one without the other. In other words, what we view as unfolding global chaos is actually a carefully scripted and manufactured order, which means that our current reality is being resculpted and redesigned and reordered to manifest their version. Okay. Now this was, this I'm sure at this point is really easier for people to see when it comes to all of these other countries, right? There's all this chaos. This group of people that are bent on global dominance and global governance are going into these countries and destabilizing them. That's the chaos. Because they plan to put in their own puppet ruler that will go along with global governance, which is the order that they get out of the chaos. They're building a new world on the ashes of the old one. So people can see this principle working, okay? Where it's not, I mean, this is playing out over and over and over, but I think where people are not aware that it's working is in the environmental movement, okay? And this is the Hegelian dialectic, which is thesis, antithesis, synthesis. And that basically means that you create a problem, and this is order out of chaos methodology, okay? These go together. You create a problem on purpose. You blame it on something else. You obviously don't want the entire population of Earth to know that you're the one behind the problem. You blame it on something or someone else, and then you terrify people. Oh my God, this is terrible. We must do something about it. And then when you get everyone to agree or even clamor for help, yes, come help, save us, you institute the solution that you always wanted to institute. It's the revision you always wanted, but in order to do it without resistance, you have to con people into participating and going along with it, even wanting it, welcoming it. So this is part of the order out of chaos thing too. But then I want people to really recognize this particular aspect is the incompetence meme. This is, you can see this everywhere with Ebola, can't you? There was the, was she the medical advisor to CNN or something, was supposed to be quarantined for 21 days, and the media caught her getting a hamburger, right? She broke the quarantine to get takeout food. All these people are incompetent. And then the CDC, you know, they're letting people infected from other countries come here. Oh, they're incompetent. Oh, Obama, he's incompetent. Everybody's incompetent. No, this is competent incompetence. It's order out of chaos. They want chaos. They need chaos because their order is the replacement for the reality we had before the chaos. You see? Now, this...
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so this meme also creates a psychic block because it loops thought patterns into thinking these people are just idiots. They just don't know what they're doing. But in fact, they know exactly what they're doing. And if you can keep people looped into the idea that these people are just incompetent, the mind never strays out of the loop long enough to recognize it's purposeful and that there's intent behind it. It loops them back to the narrative.
Crystal, I am noticing people are starting to wake up and they are starting to ask these questions. I mean, people that I've been shocked that they actually are starting to speak up and saying, you know, I'm seeing patterns here that some just isn't right about. And I'm like, really? Oh, ask me some more questions because this is interesting. Someone that I just never imagined, a friend of mine, a longtime friend of mine, she started asking me questions a few months ago. It's like, I stopped watching television. I'm like, why? Because it's all the same thing. It's like a movie plot. It's a movie plot being played out on the news. I'm like, oh, you noticed that? Well, yeah, but there's nothing, what can I do about it? There's nothing I can do, so I just turned it off. I said, well, that's one position to take.
That's right. I mean, it is true. We need to get them out of the fiction, but then they need to start looking at reality, right? If you know that you're getting up every day and responding to a fiction, don't you want to know what you should be responding to? What is really happening?
Yeah, Crystal, I think that there are so many people, and like you said, we're running out of time, that I feel that there are so many people that have thrown their hands up. They're so confused. They've been so misdirected. They don't know who to trust anymore. And
right.
This is,
and
the alternative media has done a lot of damage in this, because I got scooped up into this 3 years ago,
yeah,
and spent a year and a half in it, and I was more than pissed off. I was almost mad, like, you know, mania mad,
yeah,
over it. It really shook me to my timbers, and they are scooping up. I mean, look, this elitism, this it's on every front, not just some, everything.
That's right.
everything down to the food you eat, to the water you drink, to what you watch, what you wear, what you put on your bodies, in your bodies, even the thoughts. And yes, they are waking up, but it's, oh, jeez.
Well, this is the other thing. Yeah, I mean, this is the other thing that I endeavor to teach people wherever I come across it, and that is the design and what I refer to as proper knowledge. Because if people have proper knowledge, they can't be snowed. You can't do it. So let me give you an example of what I mean with the Ebola narrative, the Ebola pandemic narrative. This is how bad it is, and I really hope that people get what I'm about to say, and I really hope it makes the hair on the back of their neck stand up, because this is really how far gone it is, okay? Millions of people, maybe even billions of people all over this planet are being taught to fear an Ebola virus pandemic. They're even talking about, you have all these lateral narrative binders about, oh, how you can communicate it this way, and we're working on a vaccine. Ebola is not a virus, it's a parasite. It's a worm parasite. You cannot vaccinate against a parasite.
Yep.
Okay? So if they come up with a vaccine, what in the hell will actually be in it? You know, people have all kinds of theories. You know, it's a microchip, it's this, it's that. I don't know what it is, but it damn sure isn't going to be an Ebola virus vaccine, because there is not an Ebola virus. It's a parasite. You cannot vaccinate against a parasite. This entire thing is a fraud. It's an absolute fraud. It's not real. And then if we look at the Sandy Hook, quote, massacre, right? Not 3 days after I finished that essay on reality revisionism, and of course that essay goes into, this is why they use the term theater. You know, you have the Middle Eastern War theater. That's the term they use. They call it theater. This is why they use crisis actors. It's not, you know, it's not real. There's a wonderful researcher into Sandy Hook, and his name is Wolfgang Halbig. He did a presentation that you can find, I hope you can still find, on YouTube, where he did this presentation in person with a group of Oath Keepers, which I also recommend people check into. And he explained that he knew these people were actors. He knew who the lead actors were, he knew who the supporting actors were, and he also had copies of their scripts. See, this is the thing. These people know that we don't respond to, you know, as Kissinger used to say, or and I'm sure probably still believes, it's not a matter of what is true. It's a matter of what is perceived to be true, because that's what people respond to.
Crystal, they made a movie called Wag the Dog that is describing exactly what you're talking about. They made a movie on it.
That's right. And people, I think... You know, I think people are beginning, I think people have seen the black cat walk by twice enough times. They have seen the inconsistencies and discontinuities enough to know that there's something very, very wrong here. And there is something very, very wrong here, and we need to stop it. And this is the other thing. So what do we do? How do we mm-hmm. prevent this civilization from going off the edge the same way all the others did? Well, first and foremost, we have to, if we eliminated corruption on this planet, we could do it. That's first and foremost. The corruption has to go bye-bye.
I concur.
The sooner the better. This attempt at globalism is the basis for most of this corruption. That has to stop. And it's not enough. You know, people, you know, you get a lot of this new airy-fairy, new agey stuff. Well, if you just ignore that and build your own reality, look, people don't get it. How did that work for people in the witch hunts and the Inquisitions? How did that work for them?
Oh, let me retitle it. Do nothing. We've got your back. We'll take care of it all. Just keep waiting.
Yeah. Jesus is going to come and fix it, or somebody else is going. No, there's nobody else. There's us. And these people have to be removed from power. Yeah. We will not survive if they aren't. I'm not going to sit here and give people how that should be achieved, because I don't know. And I don't want to say, well, you must do it this way, because I don't want to preempt a different future in which someone else has a better idea, because maybe they do. I don't know. All I can say is it has to be done. And I think that there are signs of this on the international stage as well, that there are signs that people understand this. A few days ago, I listened to President Putin's speech at Valdai, and he also did a Q&A session with people, and he specifically talked about how the global governance scheme has failed. It's done the opposite of everything that it's promised. It has robbed people of their right to self-determination. And you hear people talk about, you know, their natural rights, you know, your right to life, liberty, the pursuit of happiness. But if you don't have self-determination, you can't have those others. That is the ultimate right, is your right to self-determine your own future. We live in a world where people can't even self-determine what goes into their own body. And I'm not talking about drugs. I'm talking about raw milk, you know, colloidal silver, you know, marijuana for healing cancer. SWAT teams are raiding people that are selling raw milk. And people don't Yep. know this, but the founder of the Mayo Clinic healed people for 18 years with raw milk. That's how powerful it is, which is why they don't want us to have it. You see, it's backwards. It's just like Orwell said, you know, peace is war is peace, truth is lies. It's exactly right, because even if you look at Common Core and how bad Common Core is, you know, a moment ago you were saying how people are just so confused, they're throwing their hands up in the air and giving up. There was this wonderful video that I shared on Facebook a few days ago about Common Core. This fellow was doing a lecture on it. It's about 50 minutes. And at the end, there's a statement, a testimony actually given by a woman who is a psychotherapist who, her caseload, I think, represented, she said, 20 different school districts in her area. And she talked about how she started getting calls from parents of eighth grade honor students and how they were self-mutilating and cutting. And she was asking She was asking these kids, and they were saying, well, we can't do it. We feel stupid. We can't take the pressure anymore. And pretty soon the children were getting younger and younger and younger, and they were doing everything they could. They were throwing tantrums. They were doing everything they could to get out of going to school, and they were so upset that they were vomiting because they said it made them feel stupid, like they couldn't do it. They didn't want to go. And then she got to the teachers, and the teachers were suffering from astronomical levels of depression. And anxiety because of Common Core, and it goes through some of the math problems that they're using for Common Core. And in this one segment of the video, this girl is showing her mother, who I think is an engineer, how she's being taught to do math. And it was a question like, you know, if you add 1,328 to 1,107, well, first she had to draw a cube. A cube represented the thousand, so she had to draw a cube picture for every thousand in both numbers, and then squares were hundreds, and then lines and dots were tens, and it took this child
what?
8 minutes. It's in the video. It took this child 8 minutes to solve a problem that could be solved in 30 seconds by carrying the ones. When you do
you
the
mean
stack.
To tell me they've removed the numbers and replaced them with
Yeah, they're trying to. And it's just, I mean, that's how bad it is. And here's the other thing that this therapist said. She was very upset because she was getting calls from parents who were saying that in some cases their children didn't have textbooks, so they didn't even know what their children were learning, and they couldn't help their children with their homework. Because if you use, where they're rolling out this Common Core, if you use, as a parent, the traditional way of adding and subtracting by carrying the ones, you know, you stack the numbers and you add them and carry the ones, whatever, they automatically fail. They will fail your child. They are trying to phase common sense out of the equation. So, because, and we have to remember, this is a return, we're really kind of returning to the Dark Ages. And we know that slaves were, it was illegal to teach them to read and write for a reason.
Yep.
So when I say that you're not being taught intelligent design, I absolutely mean it. It's very, very important that we return to it. Here's another example of why intelligent design is so important. Okay, so I mentioned earlier about how they're constantly blaming the problems they create on someone or something else. So the global warming, quote, global warming, there is no global warming. There's weather modification. And now they're trying to say, we're all going to die, the climate, this, that, and the other, if we don't do something about global warming. And the answer to that is geoengineering. Well, geoengineering is responsible for the climate change they're calling global warming. So you see that whole circle and how that is the order out of chaos and Hegelian dialectic thing there, right?
Yeah, let's do a chemtrail campaign for 30 years, and we're going to blame it on people and their habits, and they're bringing the carbon tax credits, and
Yeah.
Oh no, we can't stop spraying. We've actually overdone it. If we stop spraying, it's gonna throw the earth into even more chaos, which is just bunk.
Yeah. It is bunk. And you see the taxes, the carbon taxes are a distribution of wealth. It's the transfer of wealth to the system so that it can continue the production of oppression. Because you have to pay people to oppress other people.
Excuse me, but Crystal, what do trees and plants thrive off of?
Well, it depends on the tree and the plant, but they need carbon.
Thank you.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what we just discussed. It's a lie. The entire thing is a lie. But here's another thing. Okay, so they blame what they have, the damage they are actually causing. They blame it on someone or something else. Mm-hmm. In this particular case, they're blaming it on us. You know, we're the useless eaters that breed too much and consume. We exhale too much carbon, and that's the problem. Okay. And global warming. Both of those are a fallacy. Those are fictions. They're narratives.
Yep.
Okay, so the same thing is going on elsewhere, and I actually just totally forgot what I was going to talk about because I was thinking about that so much. But, okay, so, oh, the alien thing. Okay, let's talk about the alien.
Okay.
Okay, so they're always conjuring up new villains, which are masks, okay? These are masks. They're myths that redirect the mind away from the true culprit. That's always the point. So we've got the archons, and we've got demons, and we've got, the Anunnaki. Look, this is all crap. It's like those cartoons when we were kids, when we actually had decent cartoons, and you would see all these people run out of a bank with their robber masks on, and they're holding the bags of money, and then they go around the corner and they change and they hide the money, and the angry mob comes and says, which way did they go? And they point, and the mob goes running in the wrong direction while they get away and laugh all the way to their hideout with everyone's loot. Okay, that's what's going on. This is blame shifting and redirection.
Well, Crystal, I actually, there may be some truth to that, and I can speak from my own personal experience. When I was in my early teens, I actually met a kid on the playground that had two sets of eyelids. And he had, just like an alligator, has a set that goes right over top of the eye.
Okay, all right, look, that does not make a person demonic.
No.
We have the freaks from the sideshow circus, and, you know, three legs, three boobs, hermaphrodites, that doesn't make people evil or demonic. And they damn sure are not in charge of what's happening on this planet. It was a kid on the playground. And this is the thing we have to get straight. So let's look at some of the lies, some of the mythology and attempts at reality revision around the so-called Anunnaki and the mythical planet X, okay? There is no mythical planet X. It doesn't exist. It's more fear porn to generate funding for space weapons, which are not going to be used outwardly. They're going to be used inwardly on us from satellites. That's what they're for.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so one of
Star Wars, Reagan years.
That's
Remember
right.
Star Wars.
That's exactly right. And in fact, this is how HAARP is aimed. And there's a wonderful, article on this. Her name is Rosalie Bertel. She was involved in the evolution of the HAARP project into when it became Star Wars under Reagan, and it's called Background to the HAARP Project. I encourage people to look at that. It talks about Project Starfish, Project Argus, all of these other things that they've done, and when people read it, keep in mind that's how insane these people are. They detonated nuclear weapons in the upper atmosphere just to see what would happen, having no idea if we could survive it. So there's a level of insanity that's almost unfathomable, you know, in what's happening here. So there's
not
that.
To mention all of these super fun waste sites now that used to be government installations that are now so highly contaminated. Like in you're a testament of that. You've had that happen.
Oh yeah, yeah, absolutely. Excuse me. So here's the other thing. Okay, so and this is really, really, it's childish, and it's sad that so many people have fallen for this, but it's constantly, and it's a form of redirecting thought patterns and looping them, okay? But part of the mythology of these Anunnaki is that they're stealing our gold because they need it to fix their atmosphere, okay? And supposedly that we're talking about a race that is 200,000 years or something ahead of us, okay? If people understood intelligent design, they would know that this is not true, because you cannot fix an atmosphere with gold. What creates an atmosphere, which we've talked about this on previous shows, my friend and colleague James Rock and I have talked about it with you before on your show. Our protective atmosphere is partially created by microbes, living microbes, and they filter out harmful radiation that comes in from the sun, cosmic bombardment. Geoengineering, HAARP and chemtrails kill these organisms, and this is why the sun looks white instead of yellow. The sun has not changed. The atmosphere through which we view it and experience it has changed, and so now we're getting a more full spectrum of light coming in. The sun looks white. It's flash cooking the plants. They look like they've been microwaved in a matter of days on occasion. It's the radiation that's coming in. There's too much radiation. Pilots who fly at high altitudes have the same problem. They can experience hair loss. So that's not true. If you really had a race of beings that was 200,000 years ahead, they would know that the study of aerobiology is about the atmosphere and the microbes in the atmosphere, and they would not be requiring gold from another planet to fix their atmosphere. And in fact, I would like to believe that they would be technologically advanced to know how to repair their own atmosphere and prevent it from getting worse. Or if they had actually went too far with that and couldn't, well, we know that there's an entire universe full of planets, and in fact, NASA had this thing they put out about all the Goldilocks planets. So they could clearly just migrate to another planet. The only people on this planet that are obsessed with our gold are Zionists. They're shekels.
Bingo!
You're the ones that want the gold. It's not aliens, okay? And this is another thing. Let's talk about reality revisions and where this all started, okay? There is a wonderful presentation on YouTube. His name is Jack Otto. And it's called The History of the Khazarian Empire. I highly encourage people to look at this. I wrote some of this down because I was hoping I would have a chance to share it and we would get to it. Because we need to go back again. You know, if you're looking at the Earth from a 30,000 foot view and you're seeing what's happening and the degradation, you have to begin drilling down in to figure out where it started and why it's happening and who's behind it. Okay? Okay, so let's see here. Okay, so in this wonderful presentation, he talks about who the Khazars were, the Khazarians, and how these people were the most brutal people to have ever existed. And at one point, they were driven out of other countries through war. They ended up mingling with Italian people because of their physical features, you know, the dark hair, brown eyes, how they eventually adopted to a degree the Jewish religion as a cover for their deeds. But this is very, very detailed because it talks about the first Rothschild and who he was. I'm trying to find the name of the guy here. Okay, let's see.
You're talking about the Anastasi Jews now, right?
Well, that's the Ashkenazi.
Ashkenazis, yeah.
Okay,
these are the ones that have... Oh.
Okay, all right. So now this is a reality revision. I want people to get how these change the nature of reality forever, okay? Okay, so there was a man, his name was Meyer Amstel Bauerberg, okay? He created the alias Rothschild for himself based on the red shield symbol that was outside of his father's silversmith shop. This fellow was born in 1943. He died in 1812. In his late 20s, which would be around 1770, he formulated a financial scheme with 12 other entrepreneurs who shared his interest in global domination, conquering the world and all of its inhabitants. Okay, they were going to do it with the financial scheme of reserve banking. And there was a precedent for this that they had learned it from, and this was the Bank of Amsterdam in 1610. So Bauerberg, who now renamed himself Rothschild, sent his five sons to foreign countries to begin setting up the financial enterprise of fractional banking, and all of these were linked together. So that meant that you could deposit gold at one of their banks and get a receipt, and then go to another one of their banks and turn the receipt in and get your gold. And then, of course, this was for your safety and the protection of your wealth, right? You didn't have to worry about robbers or pirates or whatever. Your wealth was secure. Okay. Now, here's something interesting. Years ago, I met somebody heavily involved in globalism and this mindset. Even the mindset that, you and I are Lilliputians, we're the lesser races that have to be managed because we'll just destroy everything. This person said to me one day, they flat out said to me, I was telling them, this was before I had published my first book, and I was telling them what I was working on, and they flat out said to me, the people are a bunch of goddamn sheep. They have to be told when to eat, and they have to be told when to stop. They have to be taken out to the pasture every day because they are too caught up in their own immediate needs and wants to remember where it was from the day before. And this was in response to the book that I was writing and trying to educate people about what was happening. And I said, well, look, I still have to try anyway. And they said, well, of course you do. And there was a previous conversation we had had where this person mumbled something to me, and I didn't quite catch it. And I said, I'm sorry, what was that? And they looked at me and they said, MJ12. And I'm sitting there looking at her. I'm sure she thought I was just a huge idiot because the only time I had ever heard MJ12, the Majestic 12, was in response to UFO literature. Do you remember that? Okay. Majestic 12 files. So I'm looking at her. I have no idea what the hell she's talking about. And so I say, I'm sure there's something more in what you're saying, but I just don't know what it is. And she said, there are 12 families that run the world, and there's nothing that you can do about it. So think about that. Think about what Jack Otto just said here about these 12 different people that started all of this, okay? Okay, so these people, okay, let's go back here. Where did I leave off? Okay, so these people are responsible for the formation of the League of Nations, which is the precursor to the United Nations, and this is in its current form, and this is super important to understand. It was around this time that the Illuminati was created to help execute their goals and their conquest. At the 15-minute mark in the video, Mr. Otto mentions a game plan they had, and it goes into the Battle of Waterloo, which is important because Waterloo was a game changer. Now, there's a whole nother side to the Waterloo event, which I don't want to get into today. Okay. But these people, so basically what happened was this was a massive reality revision because supposedly Rothschild was told via a carrier pigeon that Napoleon had lost, and he got the information before the public did. But instead of telling everybody that Napoleon lost, he behaved erratically and as though he was afraid, and he let it leak out that Napoleon won. Okay, and this began a massive transfer of wealth based on a fictional narrative of the war. It was a reality revisionism because the people were so scared that Napoleon had won. They were afraid that their government wouldn't be able to honor its financial commitments. Okay, so they began selling off all of their securities. And when they did that, Rothschild and his associates began buying them up, and this increased his wealth 21-fold on that day. When that happened, that was a reality revision.
Oh wow!
You
So
get what I'm
this
saying?
what? Oh, this
Okay.
was fast forward into the here and now. No wonder why they've been producing all of these sideshows with these bombings, because it affects our stock market.
Yeah, the whole thing is rigged,
Yeah,
yes.
yeah.
Okay, so the reason he wasn't strung up, because obviously you'd have a lot of really pissed off people that found out they just sold all of their valuables while you gobbled them up under false pretenses. He disappeared for a while, okay? But Baron Rothschild then had the means to force a reformation of the Bank of England, and then he put his associates in positions of power. From here, a meeting was later held in Vienna, where he had a bunch of his associates from around the globe attend this agenda, trying to convince world leaders that in order to stop the scourge of war, some type of global congress had to be created. And this began the League of Nations, which is what we now see as the United Nations. And people really need to get this. The United Nations is the Trojan horse of the globalists. And this is why this is what Agenda 21 is. Now, Jack Otto went over the 6 points of this plan that they had for world domination, and one of them was the end of all religions. A super important one, was the end of private property ownership. And if you go to Agenda 21, which is Agenda for the 21st Century, written by the United Nations, one of the things that it seeks is the end of private property ownership for us, the common people. And of course, the financial collapse fed into this, didn't it? Because who ended up owning all of these properties? The government, through the bailouts. And they're still empty. So that was a way to get people out of their homes and steal their property. But there are others. The carbon tax scheme will do the same. But eventually, they want to herd all of us into these huge cities and cordon off nature. We want, there will be no human zones. But there's an excellent researcher on Agenda 21. She wrote a book called Behind the Green Mask, and her name is Rosa Corey. I think it's Corey. I've been pronouncing it Core for a long time, I think, inappropriately, but her last name is spelled K-O-I-R-E. And if you listen to some of her presentations on Agenda 21 and how it's being rolled out, it's already being rolled out in our local communities, she has said before, and people really need to get this, that it subsumes individual rights in favor of a global collective. And this is really important. In the essay that I wrote about the unsustainable reality revisions, it goes back through the history and actually provides documented proof that Edmund de Rothschild is behind the environmental movement and that this is the order out of chaos methodology that they're using. Now, the fellow who produced this video back in 1992 was at their meetings and realized something big was going on, because these were local environmental meetings back in like the 80s. And all of a sudden, Rothschilds and bankers and CEOs are showing up, and he knew something was going on, and he began to document what they were doing. And he even has audio clips of them talking about their involvement in this. So it's not speculation anymore, it's proof. But one of the things he talks about is the fourth world. Okay, Maurice Strong was the marketing agent for Rothschild. The Rockefellers fund a lot of this. So this is where it began, though, with Edmund de Rothschild. The fourth world, the first three worlds are power blocks, political power blocks that have emerged out of world wars. The fourth world is supposed to be the only world left having consumed all of the others. And he makes this fellow who his name was George Hunt, and the video is embedded in the essay. It's only 30 minutes and it's fantastic. He discusses what the fourth world really means and how the Native Americans, their shaman, knew about this coming fourth world, and they referred to it as the lostness of mind, and that people would be coerced through drugs and fear and various other methods of handing their ego, suppressing their own ego in favor of collectivism. And this is a major disconnect that I have always had with the New Age community, because they are constantly saying that you need to destroy your ego, your ego's bad, you're bad, 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 ego, get rid of ego. This is coming from the globalists. They're the ones subsidizing and funding this mindset. This is where it came from, because that is their goal. And what we have to get is their new world religion is Gaia worship, and they will enforce it the same way we had witch hunts and inquisitions before. There will be a return to that.
Crystal, there is even something else that's going on that is deeply, deeply really affecting me and ticking me off, and it's these vegans and vegetarians. They're also, these love and light of New Age movement are even, shunning people over a diet. Yeah.
That's right, and this also comes from Agenda 21, and I know that there are people that choose to be vegetarians. Hey, that's great. You have the right to self-determination. If that's what you want to do with it, good on you. Go right ahead. But there's a dietitian whose name I cannot remember at the moment, and I don't have her books over here at this desk with me, but I actually was turned on to her by James Horak, and she wrote this several books, but she's really the most famous dietitian that there has ever been, and her books, I think, are no longer in print. They're from, I think, the 60s, 70s, maybe. Excellent books, but in every single case, when she's talking about people's ailments, she's talking about the need for more protein, especially during flu season, because protein is essential for a healthy functioning immune system. And if you look at that, and I've talked about this before even a year or so ago about the Hunger Games. Do you remember that? Mm-hmm. How that whole thing was set up? They weren't eating meat. They were weak. They were, you know, their place in society had been determined for them. They were born into it. This is what the Trans-Pacific Partnership is setting up. The Trans-Pacific Partnership is the it's the corporate charter for the New World Order, where they're divvying everything up, deciding who gets what countries are going to be responsible for contributing what resources, and their people will be locked into that. And going back to, like, you know, the narrative binders and how they loop people. If you'll recall, in the Hunger Games, she was in this virtual reality program, which was the game theater, right? When she was, her and these other children that were supposed to kill each other. When she would get too close to the edge, they would throw fireballs at her and or send other people towards her to redirect her, okay? This is an analogy that I like to use to help people understand that we have a reality box, a sanctioned reality box that we are allowed to bounce around inside of. We are allowed to think these thoughts in this box. And if we try to go outside of that box, we're punished for it and we're redirected the same way she was in the Hunger Games. I mean, you can see, you know, there also was this really wonderful film that came out recently called Divergent. I don't know if you've seen it.
Yeah,
very good. Same principle again. They were using technology to try to discover who the heretics and dissenters from the program would be based on their thought patterns. And those with thought patterns that didn't fit into the box were called divergent, and they were hunted and destroyed.
Yep.
Yeah. This is the future that we're entering. And at the same time, we have billions of dead fish washing up all around the world. These are food sources, and this goes back to manufactured lack, and I really want to, I actually have to go soon, and I'm sure you do too, but mm-hmm. I want to get this in before we stop. I want to talk about manufactured lack. It is a lie that the world is overpopulated. People have to understand this. If you, I had a difficult time trying to get people to understand that the lack is being manufactured so that they can turn around and blame overpopulation. And I was expressing my frustration to my friend James and how difficult it is to get across. And he said, well, what is overpopulation? He said, isn't it that there aren't enough resources for everyone? And I said, that's right. And he said, so if you go to the jungle where the Aborigines live and you cut down all the trees, now it's overpopulated, isn't it? This is what they're doing. And we have to stop them, because the way they're going after major food sources, and it's not just the fish in the sea. We saw the Gulf of Mexico, what happened there, that's not edible. We saw Fukushima, what happened there, that's not edible. We're seeing all of these mass death fish die-offs everywhere, that's not normal. We know that fish are very sensitive to water temperature. We know we have ionospheric heaters that can do that. But then you also have the weather modification with the crops. And this is how you know, because one of the tenets of intelligent design is that everything is given for the purpose of regiving, and that nature constantly balances itself. And part of the weaponization process of the design is to prevent the rebalancing. So when they're using weather modification, this is how you know. You have drought on one side and flood on the other. And this is the problem that we are having here in this country. California is in a huge drought. And by the way, that was planned. And that's in that video from 1992, that they had planned to turn California into a desert, and they're working on it. But meanwhile, in the Midwest, actually, here, we have floods, and you can't grow crops in either region, so there are going to be food shortages. And if we do not stop these people and we do not get them away from the buttons, in the not-too-distant future, we are going to find ourselves in a situation where we are going to have to decide who eats and who doesn't. And I don't want to do that. I'm not willing to do that, because that should never happen. So we really have to get a handle on this. We have to stop looking at mythical monsters. There's no boogeyman under the bed, but there are some real, really, really awful sick people in power. And if they have their way, none of us will survive it, not even them. And I'm sure that in the previous lineages, there were people who thought just like them, that thought they could find some way to survive while they did the rest of us in. And how did it work out for them? We're digging their civilization. organizations up. Didn't go very well. I know that they're trying to constantly insert into the narrative that they can hide in their bunkers or they can go hide in space. Well, they can't go hide in space because they don't have a way to shield themselves from the radiation.
You've got the eugenicists right now that are trying to merge man with machine, and getting close.
And eugenicists mean something along the lines of good genes, and people don't know that in the 1950s that was relabeled transhumanism. Eugenicists are behind transhumanism, so when people think that they're going to be augmented to become better human beings and faster and stronger, that's absurd, because the people that are actually instituting Common Core and feeding you contraceptive corn, look what they've done to you. Do you really think they're actually going to augment you to be better people or better slaves? That's what people don't get. They really need to look at that. It's the transhuman tragedy is what it is. But I want people to know these people do not have a method whereby they can escape the consequences of doing the rest of us in. And I can tell you precisely how you know that, because their disdain for us is so, so great that if they could have done it, they already would have. They haven't. Their bunkers, I don't think, are going to help them out in the future, because after Fukushima and the melted cores having went China syndrome, we're seeing earthquakes that are 350 miles deep. I don't imagine that bodes well for their bunkers underground. And then the space, you know, the space narrative is a complete lie. Even the space station is in low Earth orbit, so it's still being protected from cosmic bombardment and radiation. And that's one of the ways that people know that we didn't really go to the moon, if they understood intelligent design. I apologize for that, Dale. But that's how people would know that, because they've done tests in a laboratory where they discovered they were shooting beams. It was a laser beam simulating, I think, gamma radiation, and it cuts through living tissue like bullets.
Yeah.
We did not go to the moon in what they said we went to the moon in. It's impossible. And there's a documentary, a great BBC documentary that I also put on my blog, that talks about what some of the astronauts went through while they were very briefly exposed to excessive amounts of radiation, and it does cause damage. So they aren't going to be able to go hide up in space like their movie Elysium. I don't know if you've seen that. And we see more and more of this, don't we? And this is the other thing people have to remember, that class warfare is about these people believing that they have the right to write the script and that the rest of us are observers. And class warfare is about keeping us in our place as observers, non-participants.
The insanity of humanity, and the ones that really need to begin shock treatment are running amok. Yes.
Yeah. But I will say very quickly, though, I do want to bring this up because I didn't quite get to it before, about Putin speaking. Putin was talking about BRICS and the BRICS nations. That is the alternative to global governments. So people have to begin to recognize, and I think this is a very, very good thing, that it's not just people like us, you know, the, quote, conspiracy people that are recognizing what's happening and where it goes. We had a world leader in a two-hour presentation talk about precisely some of the things that we talk about how, why self-determination is so important, why globalism removes it, why it's a failure, and how this BRICS combination is a system, an alternative system that's being designed to challenge it. So
get behind BRICS and drop Putin an email. Let him know how you really feel and what kind of a direction. So this isn't a done deal then.
No, it's not a done deal.
We really haven't, you know, here I've just been under the impression that we're pretty much toast.
We are not toast, but okay. I do want to reiterate the importance of why you can't just go off and build a new reality and let these people go. They have access to the technology that destroys civilizations, and they keep hitting the buttons. So they have to be removed. It's not a matter of, well, we can just ignore them and phase them out. I can't ignore somebody who can aim harp at my country and destroy my crops. I can't ignore that. Do you see what I'm saying? They have to be removed because they have access to the technology that they are. It's knowledge being misapplied to our detriment, and if it continues, it will and is causing catastrophic biosphere and biodiversity collapse. And once we cross a threshold, that's it. There's no going back, and we're almost there.
Mm. Crystal Clark, I want to thank you very much for coming on the show. I know our time is up, and gosh, I want to have you back because I think that we've got some more things to talk about and in the future here. And gosh, what a wealth of information you brought. I want to thank you and the listeners too. And I'll have a lot of these links that she's referred to down in the bio of this video once it's posted on YouTube, so we can get this information out. And please share this. Please share this archive. Spread it wide. You have permission to embed it. Use it to your liking. Folks, it's not about making money. It's about getting this info out there and start getting righteous and you know, have the righteous people start standing up and taking action. You know, I'm very limited with my mobility, but man, we have got a young generation that are movers and shakers right now that are taking action. Maybe some misguidedness, and Crystal, I really think that you may very well have something here. Have you even attempted to approach college students that are in the social sciences with this?
No, I have not, but I do want to mention before we go that today is the anonymous Million Man Masked March. And I know that not everybody could attend, but I do want people, you know, someone recently made the comment, well, I hope Anonymous will do something more than just be seen on TV. And I didn't get a chance to say that we have to stop expecting someone else to fix it, including Anonymous. The entire purpose of Anonymous is that we are anonymous too. It's us. It's all of us.
Yep.
It's not those people. It's every people. So change begins at home.
That's right.
Yeah.
One thing that we have here in America, we have a lot of veterans, and we still have our guns.
That's exactly
they
right.
are afraid of us because we are in number. I like what Putin says. I'm seeing some posts. I'm hearing his own words, if they're interpreted properly. And I'm behind this BRICS. I really am. You know, it's
a start.
I know some about it, yeah.
It's a start. It's a start in a different direction, and that's important. So people should recognize that we do have world leaders that are also aware of the problem and doing what they can to get out of it. But like I said, just getting away from it won't work when these people have access to the buttons. So, and thank you for having me on, Dale. I always enjoy being on your show. It's always a pleasure.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. Yes, I definitely want to have you back, so. Well, folks, that's it. Another edition here of Dale After Dark. With that, good night, everybody.